Okay, I'd like to welcome you all to the special evening event. This is the only event tonight at this conference and the only event worth mentioning in the United States.
Bravo.
So we have a panel here of four science fiction greats. Unfortunately, Jerry Prunelli could not make it because he is ill, but we have on here four truly notable science fiction authors. We have Larry Niven, who has written any number of great science fiction novels, Ringworld, Footfall, Lucifer's Hammer, but Ringworld, what else can one say beyond that? Greg Bedford, the author of Timescape and many other Chasm. Okay. Jeff Landis, who's a working scientist at NASA Glenn Research Center, who wrote Mars Crossing, and also numerous short works, including I think one that won the Hugo Award. David Brin, the author of Star Trek Rising, The Uplift War, The Postman, which was screwed up as a movie, but I'm sure the pay was good. that was a pretty good movie. But actually, an author of many great books, The Practice Effect,
Birth,
Existence, Earth, so forth. So anyway, these guys, as I think I mentioned this morning, this is like having a panel a generation ago featuring Heinlein, Asimov, and Arthur Clarke.
Bravo.
So it's extraordinary. And so I'm just going to moderate the panel and try to avoid speaking, except probably won't. it's about the human future in space because. To a very real extent, I think the space age is a creation of science fiction writers. Once we started learning that, there were these other planets out there, and they were Earth-like to one degree or another, and so there could be civilizations there, and what are the possibilities, and what is the possibility, that science opens up in terms of what people can do beyond, planetary stuff, but just in general, and what are the true possibilities for existence? And if you look at popular culture today, it's defined. Our vision of the future is defined by science fiction, and in particular by two alternative views of that future. One of which is an expansive view, if you will, the Star Trek future of humans venturing out into space, and things aren't perfect, and it's certainly not without risk, but it's filled with adventure and possibilities and opportunities. And then there's the alternative future in which we do not go into space, and we remain confined to one planet with shrinking possibilities, and you might call that the slightly green version of the future. And there they are, and they're very significant because they, one argues that we should promote human freedom, the other says that it is doomed, it should be restricted. One argues that ultimately all humans are friends because the more creativity we all exercise, the more possibilities there will be for all of us, whereas the other basically says we're all competitors for a shrinking piece of a shrinking pie. Anyway, with that, I'm going to throw some questions at the members of the panel. I'm just going to start, first of all, what's your vision of the human future in space in the next 100 years, in the next 1,000 years, in the next 10,000 years? Where are we going? What do you think is really going to happen ultimately? Putting aside, this administration, that administration does that, and this program gets it. But how's this thing going to hash out? How about Greg Benford or whoever wants to start?
Thanks, Bob. Let me say one thing. I said Bob you could frame it on the scale of a century if you ask two questions, which are part of your general question.
I'll ask those questions, but I want to...
Oh, you're going to answer that. I'm an optimist. I think Howard is always the right direction. And we're speaking in a country that is known for this position, and there's a reason for that. Larry.
Space was going to be easy. Space was easy because science fiction writers wanted it that way for the purpose of storytelling. Mars was inhabited. Mars was always inhabited, even when I wrote it, which was 53 years ago. We're gonna have space travel. We're gonna testing.
Yes.
All right, there you
go. Sometime in the past 300,000 years, someone had painted a smiling face across the Earth's moon. I wrote that as an opener when a class was writing openers for stories. Narrative hooks. I never used them.
So you're gonna have it.
I don't know what the future of space travel is gonna look like. I'm not easy with politics. But it's still true that the asteroid belt contains the wealth of the universe. And we haven't invented it. It's raining soup, and we haven't invented soup bowls yet. Gary Cornell's claim.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go out there. We're going to get rich doing it. We're going to take over the solar system and eventually develop a Type 1 civilization.
Which masters the solar system, right? The Kardashians.
Type 1 masters the Earth.
Oh, that's right.
We haven't mastered the Earth yet, but we need to take over the solar system to some extent to master the Earth. Terraforming will be performed first upon the Earth, but we'd be better off working with Mars just to learn the basic rules.
We're going to Mars. If not this generation, and I certainly hope it's this generation, we are going. If not this generation, the next. If not that, the next. That's going to happen. It's going to happen because Mars is out there. It's a real place. And we as humans expand outward. That's what we do. That's part of what is us. But Mars is not our destination. Mars is just a stop on the way. One of the many planets that we're going out to as we colonize the whole solar system from Mercury out into the Oort cloud as perhaps a pause on our way even further out. I think that we're going to colonize the solar system. We're going to make it out. There's a lot of planets out there. There's a lot of moons. There's a lot of places that we could go to. And you know what? They're all exciting. I want to go everywhere. I want to go to all the places. I want to visit Triton. I want to visit Saturn, exploring the atmosphere of Saturn. There is a lot out there. We need to go.
Now you know why he's been nominated for more Hugos than almost anybody. I'm following that like that. Well, you start by trying to take a big picture perspective and be contrary. My blog is called Contrary Brand, so as much as I agree with absolutely everything Jeff says, I'm also going to say that I don't think that's true. I don't think there's any causal relationship. If you look across the last 6,000 years, 99.99% of our cultures were horrible pyramid-shaped oligarchies in which feudal families inherited power and made sure that, above all, there was one priority, and that's making sure their sons would inherit other people's sons and daughters. Mm-hmm. And under those circumstances, if you ever read Ray Bradbury's short story, The Flying Machine, the emperor kills the guy who makes the flying machine because it destabilizes. But is that necessary? Is that necessary to happen? Pretty much exactly 100 years ago, no, actually 120 years ago, Frederick Jackson Turner wrote a book that scared everybody in America called The Closing of the American Frontier. And it talked about how, right before everyone's eyes, within just 30 or 40 years, all the really prime real estate that had been stolen fair and square from the natives was being snapped up. And that an actual frontier beyond which you could just remake yourself, change your name, remake yourself, which had been in the, at least white American, and then, thankfully, because we expand our definitions, American psyche, was gone, or would be gone shortly. And he said, well, this is probably going to have a simple effect, and that is this expansive, individualist, irascibly confident, optimistic that you can remake yourself psyche that made us so different will shut down and we'll become another hierarchical, silly people like Europeans. But he said something very smart. He said, and this was 1893, he said, there's a possibility that these habits of thinking have become so ingrained in our mythologies and the way we think that we'll simply invent new frontiers. Within 10 years, Americans were flying through the sky. And that, as you see, it's not a foregone conclusion that just because it's there, we're going to have to fight for the kind of civilization that fools brilliant young men into saying things like, of course we'll go, because it's there. You're a product of this marvel. We all are.
I'm proud of it.
So is this conference, and so is he.
Well, okay, I'm going to ask a short question to each member of the panel, but then I'm going to follow it up and ask an explanation. Okay, first of all, do you believe there's life in space? Just